Good evening, everyone, and welcome to tonight's edition of I Heard That. I'm your vibe, Mr. Stephanie Renee, joined as always by my co-hostess with the mostest, Sharice.
Hello.
Very colorful. You're feeling very tropical today.
Yeah, listen, I'm trying to will spring into the building. Okay.
Please.
Can you please come and stay? That's what I'm trying to do. You know, I figure if I keep doing this, maybe it'll be inspired to come around and stay because, you know, these March winds.
Yeah. And when you're not directly in the sunlight, like directly in the sunlight during the day feels kind of nice. But yeah, the minute the sun moves, it shifts and you are back in shadow, all of a sudden you realize that it's chilly.
Yes. Stiff. The wind been snatching trees from the root out the ground. So, yes, we want to. Can spring please come on? Come on, spring. Listen, we ain't gonna be mad at you. Just come on.
And right, as we say wind and all that, I would like to just take a moment today to remember the people involved in the Francis Scott Key Bridge collapse. Because listen, y'all know I'm from DC. I'm not from Baltimore. I'm from DC. But anybody who lives in the DMV, who does that 95 stretch at any point, is very familiar with the Key Bridge.
Yeah.
And I fell asleep before the news came on last night, and so I didn't hear about it until this morning, and then they showed the footage. And yeah, listen, yeah, I cannot even imagine.
And I was like, nothing what I was imagining just from hearing it. Horrible. Yeah.
So I want to acknowledge the bodies that they have recovered and the ones yet to be recovered. But most importantly, when you realize that it is already going to be horrible, thank God for the captain of the ship who leaned on the horn, who called in a mayday. And because he knew it was going to be bad and called, they were able to stop other cars from driving onto the bridge before the moment of impact, because those people would have ended up in the water also. And yeah, God only knows how many years it's going to take.
Right. It's reconstruction.
So, you know, I just needed to say that, because we're going to be in this space and we're going to be all love and music and everything, yeah, else. But we know that around the world there's so much going on, but that one is very close to home. You know, that yes, is right here in this middle Atlantic,
right,
North Atlantic space that Sharice and I reside in. And yeah, so, you know, any of you who might be tuning in from a little bit further south of us, know that our hearts are with you. And right, and we certainly hope that the city of Baltimore and Baltimore County are going to be okay in the midst of this tragedy.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
So with that, oh, and listen.
Absolutely true.
It's true. It's true.
No mercy.
Something, I don't know what. And I think, I don't know that it would have been so bad. Like, we wouldn't be so sensitive to the fact that it's still chilly if we hadn't gotten a couple of days up in the 70s where it, right, just felt amazing, right?
That, and one then, weekend, that one weekend, it was like warm, and it's like, oh, I mean, legit warm, like the air, yes, was warm to,
yes,
breathe, and
no coat was warm, like it was, yes, great.
And then that the next day, it was, you were back in the winter, and I'm like, hello,
25 degrees lower than it had been. So right, yes, so we hope that the songs that we put together for tonight's program are going to warm you up in a, yeah, personal and special way, because, yeah, we are giving honor to the producers, ladies and gentlemen. Our theme for tonight is Behind the Board. So these are the folks that have a vision,
yeah,
and know how to take the talent that's in the booth and elevate what they're doing and make it something special. So that's, we right, absolutely want to show some love. And we, Sharice and I had the conversation when we were talking about doing this theme, and we said, you know, we can do anybody except Babyface and Teddy Riley, because during the time of Versus, right, that was a big one.
That was the first one.
Right. You know, this whole notion of how we compare and everything else. So we didn't want to focus on one producer, and we wanted to, you know, love them, but just give them a little bit of rest and let some other people come into the conversation with our selections tonight. And we are definitely doing that. We are all over the place in terms of the influences that we're going to share with you.
I love it.
And so, and Charisse, I didn't tell you before we started your first song. So your first song up to bat is a song that I used to have on 45.
Oh.
So just so people are clear about the fact that we're talking about, generally speaking, late 70s, early 80s.
Yeah.
And I know who this producer is. So we're also going to challenge you as we set these songs up tonight to guess, or say, if you know it, say it in the chat.
Yeah.
Which producer is involved in the songs that we are sharing with you? But I simplify this artist's name because it is similar to an eatery back in our childhood. So we can call him Hojo.
Oh. Yeah, listen, let me tell you something.
Wait. Kevin said, explain to the people what 45 is. Okay, you really want me to feel old, huh?
Ooh, Lord.
Well. I will just say that we call singles, those people who still have an awareness of vinyl, we call 33 and a third records are 12 inches.
Yes.
And 45s are 7 inches.
Yes.
Small record, big hole in the middle.
That's the adapter. If you see people with that weird looking thing, that adapter was how you were able to play, because your record players were equipped or designed to play the 33 and a third records. So it just had a stick, I don't know, a dowel. I don't know what you want to call it.
Pretty much.
That you put your record on your turntable, and that's how you played it. But the 45 had a big old hole. So you had to use an adapter, which would go over the spindle, I guess. Am I making this up? I'm making up words.
Nope.
And it would hold that, you know, was filling that space where the big hole is so that you could play the 45 on your record player.
Yes.
So 45 were singles, kind of.
Yes.
Okay.
So this song has been around since that era.
Yes. Well, listen, that was coming towards the end of the era, the 80s. We still have 45s, still have records as a regular purchase. There weren't CDs, and well, they were cassettes. Well, yeah, they were cassettes then, but not.
Yes, and singles.
And we had come out of the 8-track era, which came right before we were buying music. I never bought an 8-track. I've seen them, but I never bought one.
My father had an 8-track in his shaft car.
I remember seeing the player in the car, and that's how I know that I saw actual 8-track tapes, but I never operated. I still don't really understand the concept. I never thought of, never looked into it.
It was CD before CD, but it was just on that little cartridge, because you could basically on the 8 tracks, generally, those are basically songs. So you can skip forward to the next.
Oh, good.
Yeah. It flipped to the next track.
Okay.
Well, very innovative.
Yeah. A shoebox. Y'all
are showing off already tonight. Look at this.
Wait. They were huge.
It was they were big.
The size of VHS to me. That's what I always think of, a VHS tape, but for music. That's how I pictured them. So they were big. Which is hilarious.
Yes. But anyway, we digress. We got to get to the music.
So this song here, I feel like this is a certified one-hit wonder, I think. I want to say, because I don't know nothing else that this person has done. But this one hit was a hit, especially on the R&B charts. And the person who produced this album is a super producer who does not get mentioned enough when we discuss producers of music. Not only has he worked with not only has he produced, but he's a songwriter and an artist in his own right with Madden.
Who could have easily sung this song himself, but he did not.
Every song that he wrote, you could hear him singing it himself. And he did duets with some of the people he worked with. So he wrote and produced with and for Melba Moore, George Benson, Melissa Morgan. Now, I know that if you grew up with, if we, those of us who grew up on Avon Avenue in Newark, New Jersey in the 80s, right? When this song came out that he did with Melissa Morgan, which is actually a cover, one of my good friends that lived next door to us, aunt, his cousin Talitha, used to come up in the summer to visit. So we used to hang out, we used to hang tough. And we got on everybody's nerves singing the intro to the song he did with Melissa Morgan. That song was a hit again. But we just I'm a get on your nerves while I sing type person. So we just did it. Anyway, Melissa Morgan, Dionne Warwick, and he actually produced two songs on Whitney Houston's debut album.
Yes, he did.
Two. The one of them.
Right.
Was a showstopper. Yep. One of them shot her to the top of the charts immediately. Mm-hmm. And the other one is, well, the one that shot her to the charts, you can't really hear his sound necessarily, but the one that he did a duet with her, and all you hear is his style. This particular song was one of those that I don't care where you are. If they play this in a club or a lounge or a bar, wherever you at, festival, you is going crazy. You hear me?
And there's going to be a man wearing gray flannel who asks you to dance.
Just be careful. So I'm going to tell you the name of this song. And you see if you can think about who produced it. This song isn't a giveaway to the sound of the producer, because I was actually pleasantly surprised that this was the producer on this song. I was
so hear him singing this though.
I can hear him singing it, but like the sound, it wasn't his sound yet. You know what I'm saying? Like I could hear it. Him singing it for sure. And once I knew he was the producer, I was like, yeah, you're absolutely right. But the other song that we're more familiar with of him doing, you hear is dripping in his sound.
Well, come on, we gotta play it for the people so they can hear it.
So the song is So Fine by Howard Johnson. You tell
Jam
me
with us.
Don't cheat. Don't cheat and look at the screen. Just listen. Close your eyes for a little while and see if you can guess, and tell us who you think it is that produced the song in the comment section. So Fine.
Ooh. So fine. So fine. Blow my mind. Ooh. So fine. So fine. Blow my mind.
the side. Hey fellas, yeah, ain't she fine? Pull your head back, lean to the side. Hey fellas, yeah, ain't she fine?
A jam.
Yo, I love that song. That song ain't never not been hot. And it's so hilarious. The first thing y'all said, why he look like Kashif? Listen, D-Train, that's a good guess because
it was.
I would have thought D-Train if I was thinking about it, because that definitely has a D-Train sound, especially his up-tempo songs. However, you saw the picture. It's Kashif. Produced that song for Howard Johnson.
It's good stuff.
And now you know you could hear him. You could definitely hear him singing that song. Like,
absolutely.
Once I realized that, I was like,
Clutching the Pearls, Dr. Tangie Gilliam. What? You see, Charisse is peering at you through her spectacles. What? But you know what? Listen, it takes all kinds to make a world, because I do the same kind of reaction every time we mention Sade in the Soul Sanctuary radio group. And Donnie Bougelie Smith is the same thing. She is a Sade hater.
She can't take it. She cannot take it.
So, you know. It's okay. It's okay.
You definitely can get partial credit because you know it's the power of suggestion, right? Like, If I didn't know and you mentioned Kashif, it would have made me kind of like listen more closely to hear, you know, could that be him? Actually, that's kind of sound like a Kashif song, you know. But yeah.
Redemption. You think of Redemption pop?
Yes. Anita Baker, what? Anita Baker, too, what? We can't have this conversation.
Y'all are on a roll tonight.
First of all, I want to say that Kashif is no longer with us. We lost him a few years back. As with all of these artists, producers, writers who are no longer with us, we are so grateful to have the treasure of their passion still with us. What are we talking about, Dr. Tangie?
I'm not
Are you love Anita Baker? Okay. And Bill Withers.
Bill Withers.
Because what I want to know what conversation we about that we have.
She was talking about how she didn't like most of the music of that period.
Oh, okay.
So these are the exceptions.
Good.
Yes, indeed. Welcome, Sharon. We're glad to see you in the house tonight. Hey, also. Sharon. And we've got plenty more music to share with you. So
yes,
we're going to get into that.
You missed the first song unless you weren't commenting yet. But the first song was a banger. So you're going to have to definitely go back and listen to that again. So Fine, yes, by Howard Johnson. That was the song back in the 80s when I was about 12, 13. That song came out. I think it was 82. So I was like 11, 12.
It encourages you to wop it out, especially because he says throw your head back and lean it to the side. So it just, kind of.
That's right. That's right.
Works in with all of that.
That was the first one of those songs that, well, no, not the first. Well, the first in the 80s that had directions. It's one of the first in the 80s that had directions what to do.
Yeah, maybe.
One of them, at least. At least one.
But my first song of the evening, I have to credit. Now, I would have gotten to it eventually anyway. Okay. But I have to credit Rob Mitchell, shout out Penn alum.
Yes.
Because as a DJ, Rob was always testing out mixes and testing out vibes in his room.
Yeah.
And so, of course, that meant that his room, him and his roommates, that was a place I used to pass through frequently.
Yes.
High Ride South, I think. And just see what new stuff he had bought, what he was listening to.
Right.
And I happened to stop through one night when he had just gotten the 12-inch of this song.
Okay.
And I was like, oh, and now it is one of those things. Like, so I have all the feel goods of hearing it in that vibe, like literally spinning the vinyl in his room, blue light on. And also that this comes from one of my favorite groups and produced by one of my favorite producers. Okay. So I wanted to make sure that I included it in tonight's show. The album that it appears on is titled Look How Long. And it is a fabulous sophomore album. Now, we always talk about artists who get in their sophomore slumps.
Yeah.
Right. So I can tell you that they are British. I can tell you that also in this period of late 80s, early 90s, that their first album is the one that everybody raves about. The first album was called Zagora. Okay. And that spawned a whole lot of very, very popular 80s tunes. But people need to get into the catalog. And particularly because this producer really started flexing and creating sounds for his group, but also for the likes of Janet Jackson, several songs for Janet Jackson and a bunch of other people. This was the merging of the African-American sound and the British soul sound,
yes,
represented, yes, by this producer and this group. So we're going to get into the song. Tell me if you know the name of the gentleman responsible for helping to create the sound. This is Loose Ends, and the song is titled Don't You Ever Try to Change Me.
I heard that.
All right. So you all were familiar with Zagora. When I said Zagora, you all understood exactly where I was going with this. Yes. But this is one of the reasons why I decided to share this song is because one of the members of Loose Ends, I'm glad that you all know Jane Eugene, the lead vocalist, lovely woman. She is still performing and she's still performing Loose Ends songs. They came to Ardmore Music Hall here in the Philadelphia area. It must have been right before the pandemic. And so, you know, so she's still singing their material. She's got some of her own solo material as well. Lovely, lovely British woman. Yeah. Cherie, she's the kind of, you know, she'd hang with us. Like if she lived around, she's our kind of people.
Yeah, man. Yeah.
But the producer, also a member of Loose Ends, is Carl McIntosh. He also went by CJ McIntosh and has produced a ton of hits for a ton of people. So wanted to put some respect on his name and his repertoire and encourage you all to look him up. Now there's a website. I'm gonna type it in the chat and then put it on the screen. There we go. So gonna encourage you all now to use your resources. Discogs.com is an amazing resource for you to find out credits on albums. We know, clearly we know, that people aren't doing liner notes anymore, which is a damn shame. But you don't get a chance to fully understand all of the people that contributed to an album when you're just doing the downloads. So Discogs is where you go when you want to get all the inside information about who sang background, who played bass, any of that. That's where you go. So I encourage you, look up Carl McIntosh and anybody else that we're sharing with you tonight.
Yes.
And see the depth of the bench.
Yes.
Who they have created sounds for, and appreciate all that they're contributing to these recordings that we love.
That's right.
So with that, we go back to Sharice's next selection. And I have to say that I had the okey-doke moment when Cherie sent me her playlist, because I was like, she named a song and I was like, oh, I don't remember that song, but I've got this. No, I had the first album, which I still didn't even have, Cherise. I went looking for it. I was like, I know I had the album, but it wasn't in my library. So I wouldn't have had access to it anyway, even if I had the sophomore album,
right,
which this comes from. So, you know, there's a lot of pedigree going on with this group.
Yes. So I'm this is a group that came out in the mid 90s, and they actually had a lot of people working with them on their a lot of notable producers, including Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, worked with them, and they're not as widely known as I think they should be, but I'm very glad that I came across them. I don't even know how I came across them. I feel like it was when, you know, that was when we were buying like we had the BMG.
Lord.
I know that's when I got the CDs, and I think BMG was good about introducing new artists. I feel like that's maybe how I kind of came across them. Mm-hmm. And it may have been one of those featured, you got the free CD, whatever it was, you know. And it turned out to be incredible. It's like one of those like classic R&B groups, but like I'm talking about classic, like going from the 60s up to the 90s when they came out. And on their sophomore album, as Stephanie mentioned, this song, once I started listening, and I'm like, wait a minute, let me see who produced this song. Cause you know, It sound like one of those two songs on their sophomore album was this person. Well, it was actually a team. It's a duo that worked together a lot. The group is called Solo. I don't think y'all may not be exactly. Well, let me tell you, BMG, I got.
Listen,
I got mad by those low rise mailboxes. I paid so little for the amount of music that I have.
Purple. It's like streaming now.
I'm telling you.
How did you take
I paid so little for the money for the catalog, the amount of music I have. Those box sets and stuff. Oh, I was cleaning up. Mm. Cleaning up. But okay, so the group is called Solo. Y'all probably remember them from Heaven, I think, and Where Do You Want Me to Put It? I think those are like mm-hmm. the songs that they released. But before they even kind of like were releasing songs, I had both of their CDs. They have a third CD out as well. That's more contemporary. But this song here that I'm sharing, when you hear this song, I'm telling you, if y'all don't guess it, we want y'all to give us your clue, your guesses as to what sound, because you know, with producers, most producers have a sound when you hear them. That's the reason why we didn't do Babyface, we didn't do Teddy Riley, because Teddy Riley created New Jack Swing, and Babyface was producing everybody. In the 80s/90s, like, so you can recognize a Babyface song on no matter what voice is on that recording. So, but we, and that's excellent. We love the fact that we have producers from our era of music who we can say, oh, that's a so-and-so song, or that's a so-and-so song, or that sounds like a so-and-so song, because people actually had a sound of theirs, and you know, kind of like what they were bringing when they were producing these songs. So this song here, there were two that were produced by this producing duo. And I was torn between both of these songs. I was like, oh, maybe because I wanted you all to be able to hear it. You can hear it for sure, but I was like, I think this is the one. This is the one. The song is called Make Me Know It. It's by Solo from their second album called Four Brothers and a Bass. Listen, we're going to listen out and see if you can guess who produced it.
You know, sometimes I think that you don't care or love me, baby. I feel so left out. How could you do this, girl?
Just like I'm not your love, like I'm not your man. You keep me undercover, like I'm just a good friend. I wanna take your places, wanna show you new things. Girlfriends, and it's causing me pain. Sometimes I love you, it's cool to be told, but maybe I need some action shown. I'm busting my ass to get.
like I'm home and they're thrown all over the place. I feel like I'm not even wanted, and if that's how it's gonna be, maybe it would be better if I just pack my bags and leave. Ooh. Sometimes I love you, it's cool to be told, but maybe I need some action shown.
Funny tonight,
y'all. But y'all had, listen, none of those guesses is a stretch. None of them. Especially that Jodeci, man. I didn't think about that. That could have been Devontae. I mean, Devontae is the one that used to do all the producing and writing. That could have been a Devontae song. It's not a Jodeci produced song, but I think that's a very good guess.
It was.
Jammin' Lewis is a very good guest because they worked with this group on their first album, almost quite a few songs they produced on it. But it actually was Gerald Levert.
Mm-hmm.
And you can hear Gerald Levert singing that song. Once you Easily. Know that that's his song, and the other song on that he produced on their album, same. That's why I was so torn between the two songs. And I urge you to listen, to get these two albums. Solo, the first one, is the self-titled album, the debut, and the second one, as I said, was Four Brothers and a Bass. Two very, very good albums, and I can't think off the top of my head the third one because I haven't gotten that one yet. I didn't even know they had a third album, but I think it came out in like 2013. It was more recent, and I haven't gotten that one yet, but I will be getting it. And it seems like they're trying to come back into performing, and you know, they're trying to amp up their presence, and they're starting with social media. So if you want to look them up on Facebook, you can. They're there and trying to, you know, garner up their presence. So if you can help them out with that, and it's not like you're helping them, you're helping yourself, because these dudes can sing and play. And they're very talented. So, mm-hmm. But yes, Gerald Levert. And I'm going to apologize for Tiffany, because this is my sister and we just have them kind of ears. So she's going to be guessing. She's probably going to be right a lot of the times, because we just have that kind of, we are from a musical family. Mm-hmm. Myself, Tiffany, my cousin Craig is like mad about bass playing. We just, there's a lot of music. Auntie Mary Alice, my mom, we just come from a musically inclined family. So she gonna be guessing. And she gonna probably be right. And if I was in a comment section, I would be guessing too. And I am like a sore loser. Well, so I would be guessing trying to get that junk right. But yeah.
And listen, and I will say that there are all the reasons why, you know, Cherie sends me her songs, and then I've usually thought about at least what songs I want to do. And there's a rhyme to the reason with how these songs line up. And right. So we've already been talking about the producers that are involved in this next song. So this is the softball. This one wasn't even for y'all to guess. This is just for y'all to appreciate.
Yes.
I got one of those excellence.
I got one of those too.
That they have brought into this space. And particularly on this album, right? Because when we talk about the coming together of Janet Jackson and Jammin' Lewis, and now they produce for a ton of other people.
Everybody.
But there is, you know, I jokingly refer to Damon Bennett, Mr. Dizzy Fingers Bennett, as my musical husband.
Yes.
Because there are some people who just know you. And so if they're going to create music for you, they understand when Damon and I do live gigs, I don't have to tell him where I need a turnaround. If we're improvising, he gets it. Or we got Jedi mind meld. It just works.
Yes.
So with Janet and Jammin' Lewis, there is such a special understanding. And they don't force her to do anything that her voice can't do.
Right.
But they prompt her to make her voice do things she doesn't necessarily think it can do, which is also really, really special.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we all know the story about Control. That was her coming of age moment. Yes. We know the story of Rhythm Nation, because that was also a social statement, right? Right. We get into all of that. We get to Velvet Rope. Janet wanted to talk about grown folks' business.
Okay.
And so you wouldn't necessarily think that the same production team can move with you through all of these spaces.
Right.
But Jammin' Lewis have proven that their connection to Janet is real, and it's an amazing thing. Yes. Now, I'm going to say this. If you are in a situation where you can listen with headphones on, you know, any kind of earbuds, AirPods, this is the song to do it, because a lot of times we're listening to this music and we got a lot of ambient stuff going on around us, and you can't hear all of the layers of things that Jammin' Lewis particularly do in the stuff they produce for Janet. They create whole worlds, whole soundscape worlds for Janet, and especially when Janet decides she's going to get sexy with it. So this is your opportunity. If you got headphones, I'm encouraging you to put them on now and just dig back into this. I know this is the song, this is the album that some of you have probably listened to a bajillion times already. But tonight I want you to listen to it with new ears. This is, ladies and gentlemen, the title track from Janet Jackson's Velvet.
Need to feel that we belong.
Man, listen. I need, and I play that song for a very particular reason, because anytime as a vocalist, I love how far back and muddy you made all those background vocals so that it was just texture. You didn't have to understand a word of what Janet's backgrounds were saying in that. It was just like earth.
Right.
Right. For all of, and her voice is right up front and crispy. I tell every producer that I work with, I was like, I need crispy vocals for the lead. Just make my lead crispy. We can do other stuff, fun stuff with everything else.
Yeah.
But don't have me mush mouthed.
Right. Muddled.
Lead a song.
Yeah.
I want people to hear the lyrics to feel it.
Right. Right.
So that song, just their production on the entire album. I could have played so many songs from that album, but I was let's stick with the title track, because that sets the stage for what we're going to hear with everything else. And I just, chef's kiss, Jammin' Lewis.
Yes, as always. They don't miss.
Not very often, they sure don't. And so that takes us to our halfway point, and we begin the second half of the program with you. I was like, Charisse, I don't know where you pulled this one from. I was like, I looked at the title of the song and I was like, okay, well, that's kind of a long title. But then I was like, who? Often, you're not going to often come to me with something where I'm like, who? So you have
this man, once again, I'm gonna go back to when the Wiz was still alive and was selling CDs in the big barrels. It was either the Wiz or J&R Music. No, it wasn't J&R Music World.
No, no,
whoever that was that was out there.
I just hadn't thought about the barrels. Wow,
those big old barrels. And the big tables, like they used to, when they were, if it wasn't the Wiz, I can't think of who the other retailer was that was out there. If y'all are from New Jersey and remember that the store out there by Willowbrook Mall in Wayne, New Jersey, it was either the Wiz or I can't think of the other one that was kind of big still. J&R Music? No, I keep saying J&R Music.
Sam Goody?
I don't think it was that. Who?
Sam Goody?
Oh, what's the Sam Goody? One of those stores.
Did
they say FYE? No, it wasn't FYE. I didn't really start shopping FYE until they came to Jersey Garden. But and then the prices was not the same at FYE. Okay, they was crazy in FYE. But so this song, actually, I first got it from a compilation. And I think I probably got the compilation because what was on there? Oh, it's actually called Love's Train, the best of Funk Essentials.
Uh-huh. I love Funk Essentials collection, but not with this song on it.
So this one, because of the name, and it had Love's Train on it by Confunction.
Uh-huh.
And that's like one of my favorite songs ever in the whole wide world. So I was like, okay, I'm gonna get this. And then everything else was a bonus. This compilation is fire. Okay. And so the first time I heard this song, I was like, and I was saying to myself, I thought I knew all the songs by this band, but how did I miss this one? And when I, again, liner notes, which I love to read, like I'm reading a book, showed me what I thought I knew. I was off, but I wasn't all the way off, because this particular song is produced by my people. And the song is, it's so funny because the song is by the Daz Band, but before they changed their name to the Daz Band, they were called Kinsmen Daz. And they're from Cleveland. The Daz Band is originated in Cleveland. And they were originally called Kinsmen Daz,
after. I'm glad that they changed it, because that is a tongue twister.
It is. Kinsmen Daz. I don't know where the Daz part came from, but Kinsmen came from a street in Cleveland.
Oh.
I don't know what they what they call themselves Daz for, especially since Brick has that song Daz Disco Jazz. So maybe that was where it came from. I don't know. But they were originally called Kinsmen Daz. And their first two albums, if I'm not mistaken, definitely the first one, you can't even like find these things like easily because of the name change. When they got to Motown, I believe it was in 80, that's when they changed their name to the Daz Band. And so that's when they, you know, maybe the songs that you're more familiar with, they came out with. But ever since, and then I'm talking about, this is the 90s when I got this compilation CD, and I've been kind of like obsessed with this song, and I'm so glad. I wonder if this was the reason why I wanted to do producers. I can't remember, but as soon as I came up with the idea and ran it past Stephanie, I was like, oh, I already know one of my songs for sure. It was going to be this one, because I just think it's amazing that you hear, this is almost a layup for most people. It's going to have to be, because I think it's going to be a layup. I got two layups in my list. This one of them. And again, you let us know once you're listening to it, who you think produced this song. It's called I Might As Well Forget About Loving You. And it's from Kinsmen. Yes, it's a sentence. It is a sentence. Kinsmen Daz, who later became the Daz Band.
So hard to pretend. So
I mean, what's funny is the continuing to guess.
When that would be me.
You don't have to. Right.
That would be me. I'm putting everybody who I think I hear up on the screen if it was me. Okay, I'm telling you, this is my family. Listen. And right, you got it with the first guess.
Exactly.
It wasn't Earth, Wind, and Fire, but it was Philip Bailey and Ralph Johnson, along with Tommy Vaccari, who is a big producer as well. But they wrote, I want to make sure I'm right when I say that he wrote and produced it. Okay, I don't know that he wrote it, but they definitely, those three produced it. Philip Bailey, Ralph Johnson, and then Tommy Vaccari produced that song. And it's so cool because let me tell you, the Daz Band had, I don't know who, they had the right ears, because this is from their debut, the first album that they ever produced or ever created, and they were, when they were still called Kinsman Daz. Mm-hmm. This album was supposed to be produced by Marvin Gaye.
Oh.
So imagine, now you hear how the imprint of Earth, Wind, and Fire is on this song. Imagine if Marvin Gaye, the reason why he did not do it was because he got sick or something. Mm-hmm. Who knows what it was. Some medical condition prevented him from being able to do the project. The group requested and got Philip Bailey to produce this album, and in particular this song. This was their debut single. When I looked for it on YouTube, people were like, oh yes, I remember. I mean, people from Cleveland were like, I remember them playing here. I remember seeing them there. Like they have a huge following in Cleveland. I mm-hmm. mean, that's where they came from. Cleveland, they play about the Daz Band. Okay. And they remember, and the people who were remembering them from back then were calling them Kinsman Daz. They weren't mm-hmm. even saying, they would say Kinsman Daz equals Kinsman Avenue equals Kinsman Daz equals the Daz Band. Like they were like, just in case you did not know, this is what it is. This is the same band, different name, but they were definitely repping for them in the comments on the video when I went to look for it and listen to it again. And you know,
well, all I'm gonna say is that song is a far cry from Let It Whip.
Right.
But you know. But hey,
but they were still, they were in different time frames, if you will, because this was what, 78.
Okay,
this is from their debut album, which is a self-titled album from 78, and then Whip It came in the 80s, a couple of years, you know, mm-hmm. and then Funk was like kind of big, you know.
Yeah.
So know. Again, they were a funk band. That's why they won this compilation. But this particular song was the one that stood out, you know, for me from them. So, yeah.
Yes. Well, you know, I've been doing the 20 album covers, no commentary, just album covers thing. Yes. That people are doing, I can't on Facebook,
do that.
Now.
I cannot do that. I'm so glad you did it, because I got challenged too. And I was like, I can't.
But you know, I've just gone through and just sharing some of the ones I love.
Yes.
And unfortunately, she's not in our comments tonight. But when I posted this album cover, one of our friends and frequent flyers here on the program, Jen, said, I didn't know she did music. And I was like, well, ha-ha. So now I get an excuse to share more of this particular project with you all. And I gotta say that I also love when men I date know me sometimes better than I know myself. And I received this album as a gift, one of those little token things, mm-hmm. long distance relationship, brother was riding up 95 to come see me, and he just tossed it down on the couch. I was like, what is this? He was like, it's you. I was like, huh? He was like, you could have easily made this album. He's like, it sounds like something you would do. And I was he was absolutely correct. Wow. Although I do not have the same upbringing as this artist, it feels like a project in my rock diva days that I could have written and done myself. But what I love about this is, though, even though this album is the one and done, she was signed to Sony. And we know that in the day when everybody felt they needed to be signed to a major label, these major labels would sign very eclectic artists and they'd give them one album, but wouldn't see a long-term vision for how they could continue to, you know, uplift right. this very eclectic talent. And so unfortunately, Cree Summer was one of the people that suffered under that kind of system. And mm-hmm. it is not for lack of talent, and it is not right. for lack of the person who produced this entire, he executive produced this entire album. And I would make you all guess, but because I selected a photo that includes him, I won't be able to do that. But for those of you who did not know that Cree Summer sings, in addition to the 51 other things that she Everything does in else. Life.
Yes, she do a lot.
Then you need to know that she is an incredible songwriter and she's also a very able vocalist. And so her name is Cree Summer. That's not her first name. That's her two middle names, basically, because she was raised on a Cree reservation in Canada. And so there is a lot of Indigenous influence in the sounds on her project. And again, the other people that are involved with the music don't necessarily have to have your same perspective, but they got to right. know you. They got to right. understand you. They got to give you the sound that makes you sound like yourself. And so I applaud the very wonderful Lenny Kravitz for being able to do that for Cree Summer. Yes. So from her debut and only album, Street Fairy, I give you this song, which is not the lead single. And it's just one that if you have this project and you've listened to it, usually this one kind of stands out for people because you feel all the energy of it. So this song is called Miss Moon. And so it's dedicated to all of the women in our listening audience and viewing audience tonight, because this is also honoring some of the stuff about what goes on internally with us that we don't normally talk about in polite company. So, under the light of the full moon. can't hear that song and not imagine dancing around a fire.
Yeah. You know what I imagined? Driving on a motorcycle in the mountains, like in the, like around a mountain, you know, you the that thing, that's what I pictured. And hair flowing, if yes, hair flows, you know, that type of thing. That's what I was picturing.
Yeah, but I mean, when you understand like that, there's nothing about air that feels contained. It feels expansive, right. It feels outdoors, like yeah,
open air, just, you know, moving, not yes, sitting and chilling, moving some kind of yes way. That's what I felt.
Absolutely. And I just think it's beautiful that's absolutely where she comes from.
Yes.
And so not just on this song, but I think very, very particularly on this song, you can feel that sort of energy in the way that Lenny helped to create the sound around it. Yeah. So just, I encourage people, if you can find it, it is absolutely something I think you will appreciate having in your collection. And, you know, I mean, the friendship beyond a different world that, you know, of course, Cree's friendship with Lisa began first. And then because Lisa was married to Lenny, right, is the whole thing. Cree is Zoe's, how'd that come up?
I did.
Oh, you put that up. She's Zoe's godmother.
Yep.
So, I mean, you know, they're very close. And yes, that is really Summer from a Different World.
Yes.
And listen, there are a lot of vibes on that album. She goes very indigenous with a song called Nehyo. And then she goes very rock with a song called Curious White Boy. So there's a lot in between all the vibes that you heard in that one song. So I definitely recommend it. If you get a chance to listen to it, I definitely, definitely recommend it for all of you. And now we come, you know, when I got your song list, Charisse, that I laughed that this one was on there. Because I'm like, if you can't get one, you won't get another one. You worked it all together.
You know what? It was. I didn't even mean to do that. But it's funny because I almost chose a Janet Jackson song because of... I got there because of Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis working with Solo. I was like, I almost went to Janet, and I was like, let me not, you know. And then, but as I continued on, I was like, but I really enjoy this song that's my layup. Well, my second layup for the evening. You know, the first layup, it was sort of a layup because you're not familiar with the song, but this song everybody know.
Yeah.
And everybody know the singer, everybody know the producer. And I think that you know who the producer is without even necessarily listening for a sound, because most people know who produced this song. So
but it's also just an appreciation. Even though that person's sound is all up and through a song, that putting it in somebody else's hands, trusting that other person to do yes justice by your sound. Is
that's
really
what I love. That and on top of the producer's sound being safe with the artist, this particular song, they allow the artist to be who he is, because Jermaine Jackson is a bass player.
Mm-hmm.
So the fact that he was able to prominently have a prominent bass line and prominently have that bass be in front and center through this song, that's another way that you can appreciate a producer. Like you said, with Lenny Kravitz and Cree Summer, like he knew her, you know what I mean? Like, and the same thing we say with Janet and Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis, like this, in this particular song, it was like, Jermaine is a vocalist, but that's a bass player right there. You hear me? He is a bassist. And so with this song, Let's Get Serious, it wouldn't have sounded right if the bass wasn't up and in your face right along with his vocals. So that's the reason why I chose it. I wasn't trying to get a Jackson in there, but you know, but it just happens naturally. I'm just naturally connected to their sound. Each of the emanations, that word of the Jacksons. I'm on it. Like they can fit in almost every theme that we have. So I, you know, they're always, you know, in the background, like, you know, we got you. And I'm like, all right, just let me see what I can do over here first. But this one, this song, Let's Get Serious, just jumped out at me when I was on my journey through producers. And so I ain't gonna say who this producer is. I know it's a layup, but y'all let me know if you think you know who it is. You should know.
Yes, let's do it.
You should know. Listen.
No need to be rude in the comment section.
Don't listen. Listen. Craig, you know better. You can't be talking about nothing. First of all, you already know those are my people. We don't do that. Not that's your birthday twin. And you talking stuff about him? Don't and do listen, that.
I purposely chose a period appropriate image of Jermaine. And did not use the helmet head that he has grown into in his older age. I'm saying Listen, you, Sharice,
I'm not gonna.
There's no justification for the Ken doll hair.
There's no justification for it. I would like for him to not do his hair like that, but it is.
That's my one and done. I said it. I'm done.
That's what he's chosen as his hair choice. But yes, Stevie Wonder produced that song.
And that little cameo.
Hey, I was gonna say, if you didn't know before, if you pay attention to the chorus, Stevie Wonder singing chorus. That's him singing S-E-R-I-O-U-S, Baby, Let's Get Serious. Yeah. Stevie Wonder. That's why I said this was a layup, because you know, if you listen, you know. That is that Stevie on there, and you know Stevie's connection with that family is it runs. You know what?
I'm saying okay. I'm taking it down.
You know what?
We're done, Sharice. We're done.
Y'all gonna stop coming for my people, okay?
I just wanted to be noted that I didn't start it. I might have encouraged it a little bit, but I didn't start it. Okay.
Y'all gonna stop coming for my people. Craig, the man is your birthday twin. That should invoke some kind of loyalty. You know what I'm saying? Like, what?
Whew. Okay, we've had that.
That's
laugh.
It. We are moving on. Stevie,
we're gonna get back to the music now.
I'm not gonna make you guess because you're not gonna be able to guess the name of the final producer that I'm featuring tonight. But I share this as we have done in the past when we've talked about the engineers and some of these other things, that when you hear something that strikes a chord in you in some real way, don't let the love just stop at the artist. Because I have a special place in my heart for the artist that sings my final song for the evening. But it is her vocals along with the immaculate production on this album that made me stand up and take notice. And I had to look it up. And I was like, ooh. And then I looked up the discography. So again, I'm going to say Discogs is your friend. Because I said, oh, he's got a certain kind of, this producer has a certain kind of artist that he gravitates toward. Like Estero, like CeeLo, and the group that brought him to prominence. Not as a named person, but as a part of an ensemble that does excellent. So if you are a househead, lounge music person, then I'm sure you are familiar with a group named Blue Six. So this producer comes from them. Some of your favorite laid back, not four on the floor house. I'm talking about that loungy Miami Ibiza kind of vibe. Eric Stamil is his name. And so there is so much invested in this. So this is another headphone alert, y'all.
Okay.
If you have the opportunity to put something on so you can put this song up and close in your ears, then you will hear all the little intricate stuff that he's got going on in this song. But the entire album is this way. This is one of the ones where it's like I couldn't listen to it on a train because I've missed my stop type albums, you know, because I'm in it. I'm listening to all the little things that you hear fluttering and happening around in this song. So the album is titled Transient. The artist is named Gael, and she's in Addison. She's the Addison who's Haitian. I was like, child, we probably related. Because we're also friends on Facebook. But this song is just, it's wonderful. So if you aren't familiar with her as an artist, if you're not familiar with this album at all, then I really hope that as we close, I'm introducing you to something. This album's been out for like at least 15 years. Wow. So you're real late, but that's okay. It's okay
right? To be late. It's all right.
It's all right. As long as you get it under your belt, that's good. Right. And this song is called Separate Rooms.
Feel
reason why I love that song is because normally breakup songs are slow and painful.
Right.
And, you know, they're trying to drag all of that emotion out of you. She said, I can't make you happy and you can't make me care. So mm-hmm. let's go to our separate rooms and leave each other there.
That's it?
My Lord. That's all that needs to be said. I don't need no like violins trying to make me cry. That's it. Ooh, okay.
Especially if we had at the lounge or either in a right or on the beach, I'm still enjoy.
Yes,
like, I don't need to be sad.
Like, you know, but that's one of them where there's an amen corner happening on the dance floor. Like, whoo! I needed to hear that. I needed to feel that. Now I will say there's a stalker song on this album also, but I'm telling you, the production is crazy. So she's the stalker, and the song's called Parkway. The album is bananas. It is bananas. And the production on the album is bananas. Okay. But I highly encourage you to just spend some time with it, get to know it. And I'm sure that many of you out there will enjoy it as I do.
I like and what I heard so far, so that's it.
That concludes our playlist. So, Charisse, run it down for the folks that joined us late and sure, let them know what they may have missed.
Yes. Our first song tonight was So Fine by Howard Johnson. And this song was produced by Kashif.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, who produced that last song?
I'll put it in chat and put it up on the screen.
Okay. The next song that we did was Don't You Ever Try to Change Me by Loose Ends, which was produced by Carl McIntosh. Then we had Make Me Know It, which is from the group Solo. And this song was written and produced by Gerald LaVert and Edwin Nicholas. Now, Edwin Nicholas is another, he and Gerald LaVert were like a songwriting and song producing duo team, sort of like along the same lines as Jammin' Lewis, but like real R&B, you know, leanings. You know, Gerald LaVert probably can't help it. It's all the way in his blood.
Yes.
But Edwin Nicholas also produced for a lot of R&B artists, including Teddy Pendergrass, Patti LaBelle, Joe, the OJs. He did a whole lot of production for a lot of different R&B acts as well. So him coming together with Gerald LaVert, of course, is going to produce a song along the lines of Make Me Know It and then the other song that's on their album that I encourage you to get. The next song is Velvet Rope by Janet Jackson. See, I wasn't the only person to put a Jackson in this lineup. Yes, see what I'm saying? We had two Jacksons and it wasn't just me. Okay.
I love that album. I will listen to that album all the way through on repeat.
Yes, it is often. One of those. It's one of those for sure. The Velvet Rope is the album and it was produced by Jimmy Jam and Terry Lewis. Mm-hmm. And the next song was I Might As Well Forget About Loving You by Kinsman Daz. This song is from their debut album as a band before they changed their name to the Daz Band when they joined Motown in 1980. This song here, I Might As Well Forget About Loving You, was produced by Philip Bailey and Ralph Johnson from Earth, Wind & Fire, along with Tommy Vaccari, who is another big producer. The Daz Band has some good, I'm telling you, I don't know whose ear they had. But they had some people working with them, okay? Should have been their debut album, should have been produced by Marvin Gaye, in case you missed that part. But Marvin Gaye got sick, something happened, and they wound up asking for and getting Philip Bailey to write and produce on this album. And I want to also point out that not only did Kashif produce So Fine, he also wrote it. So he wrote and produced So Fine for Howard Johnson, Kashif. After the Kinsman Daz song, we have Miss Moon performed by Cree Summer and produced by Lenny Kravitz. we definitely heard Lenny Kravitz imprint on that song. So this is what I love about a producer. Like, you hear them. They let the artists be them, and then they put themselves in there too.
I want to slide in and just say also that one of the other really great songs from that album was written by Van Hunt.
Oh, really?
And yes, and it's called Mean Sleep. And so if you're a Van Hunt fan, you'll know that he basically reclaimed that song. And on his second album, he sang it with Nika Costa. So, okay. You know, this stuff kind of swirls around songwriters. Yeah. Songwriters, you know, retain the right to record their own version of the song.
Right.
And, you know, he's another one of my favorites.
Yeah, he's a good one. And it's always good to hear the songwriters' interpretation of the songs that they write. And a lot of times, like, I laugh at when I hear Butterflies by Michael Jackson, because when you hear the demo that Marsha Ambrosius did, it's, he literally was like, nah, I ain't changing nothing. I like what you did, I'm gonna do that.
He did every riff, he did everything exactly the way she did it.
He was like, you know what, this I'm not messing with it. It's good. So yep. And you know what, to think about that from a perfectionist like him, who wrote songs and threw songs away, recorded them and left them there. He literally took what she did and was like, I'm doing that. That is huge, especially from somebody of his caliber. After Miss Moon, we did Let's Get Serious by Jermaine Jackson. Oh, and let me just say this too. This was Jermaine's first number one R&B hit, and it actually edged out Michael Jackson's Rock With You as it was ranked number one on the Billboard Soul chart for the year 1980.
All right.
I would have never thought that. Now, they these two good songs, and you know they both got big airplay. They were both certified hits. Mm-hmm. However, I don't know if people would even thought that Let's Get Serious would edge out Rock With You.
Rock With You, right.
But it did. It was number one for the year 1980 on the Billboard Soul chart. Mm-hmm. Okay, so in our last song, which was an introduction to, I'm sure, all of us, to Gael, was called Separate Rooms from her Transient album from 2004, and it was produced by Eric Stamil. Producer. We want people to, and you know what, there are a lot of producers, even in hip hop, that we love the idea of them putting their sound out there. You know, when you hear a song that came from, I don't want to mention him because he's so controversial, but.
You mean the molester?
No, not him.
But I mean, he got a distinctive sound.
Oh, that one. Oh, yes. Why is there so many that I have to figure out which one?
Oh, my God. That's
absolutely a distinctive sound. The hip-hop one that was controversial a distinctive sound, like, created the whole G-funk sound for the West Coast. Like, we love that these producers have... that producers still continue to put their stamp on projects that we can actually hear them, even if we don't hear it initially. But if we're looking for a certain producer's work, and once we recognize it as such, we like, oh, you know what? That's right. You know, I love that about producers. So
as you say that also makes me say, I know when I said Blue Six, some people were like, huh? So Househeads, who are watching this now or watch it later, you all know Deep Love. I want a deep, deep, deep love. That's Blue Six. That sound, that if you can hear that song in your head, then you can hear precisely that influence on that Gael track.
Yeah, definitely.
So, you know, everybody has their thing, even if it's a lesser known producer. If they are doing a body of work,
right,
you're going to hear elements of what is their sound, their vibe, in all the stuff that they produce for other people.
Right. And that's what I just love that. I love, you know, certain songwriters, the same thing, songwriters that have that don't just write the lyrics, but actually compose the music too. You hear it then, and they wind up, you know, being, producing the albums, the songs, the pieces, if they're so inclined or whatever. But I just love the idea of somebody spreading their vision across, not just with themselves or not even with themselves, but just across different artists. I just think that's such a gift to be able to do that and to still retain the artist's identity. So you hear the producer and you hear the artist, and I just love how they get that right combo together. Yes. And it just sounds so good, you know.
Well, I've had a blast as always, and as always, you know, we share the playlist over and over again throughout the course of the show because we want you to support the yes. artists, to yes. buy the music, and to share the knowledge that you are gaining here with other people in your circle, right. because that's how we elevate the culture. And, you know, it's appropriate to say that now because 2 weeks, Lord willing, if we are back here on time, it will be the day before Soul Sanctuary's 22nd anniversary. So I definitely want to make that one a party. So Sharice and I will talk about how we are crafting the playlist for that. But, you know, I wanted to do an in-person party and then timing got crazy because it's so much going on. But we can definitely have an online party. And we're asking you to invite all of your people so we can come have a good time in the music. That's right.
Come back and bring your friends and subscribe to this YouTube channel so that you'll get notifications when we go live. In case I'm not able to, there's going to be a day when I'm not able to post. Today was tight. You hear me? I was late. There's going to be a day when I'm not able to post it, or when I'm not able to reach out to you guys and send the link to your text message, whatever. If you subscribe to the channel, you don't have to depend on me. You don't have to worry about forgetting you, because you know I have a long list and I don't be seeing sometimes. So but you won't miss us if you subscribe to the channel, and make sure you go through and like the video and take it when you have some downtime or whatever, you want to revisit, go back. Cause that's what I did. I let me look at these old videos and these songs, because again, we know we have a good time every time, but you know, we get, yes, click the bell for notifications. Cause I get notifications and I'm gonna be on here. You know what I'm saying? But yes, there was a time when I not too long ago, recently, like the last couple of weeks, that I went back and was watching, you know, our older episodes, and I was like, oh, I remember that, you know. And then just it's a good thing. We have all good shows. We have a good time.
Catalog.
We have a good time every 2 weeks. So yes. Make sure that you come back here in 2 weeks, yes. and hang with us again.
Lord willing, we're doing it again.
Purchase the music that you love. And yes, Spotify is a good source for credits as well, Daphne. I saw that you mentioned Spotify. That's where I've been going, because it's just a really quick search to find the credits for the writing and producing. They don't go into all of the personnel on these projects, but the writing and producing, definitely you can find it there. So,
yes. All right, y'all, be good to yourselves, and we hope we see you back here next time.
Yep.